You know, there's a letter from the Chofetz Chaim. The Chofetz Chaim, you can find this letter at the end of the Sefer, Chofetz Chaim al HaTorah. The Chofetz Chaim is a very, very scary letter with there. He writes, there are so many problems going on in Klal Yisrael. There are so many issues, there are so many situations. Parnassah, for example, everyone's struggling, everyone's looking. Parnassah, it's difficult to get, you know, to get a good job, to keep the job, it should pay well. People are busy with all sorts of problems and everybody's wondering, why are my tefillahs not being answered? I'm davening to Hashem, everything should go well, I should have good children, I should have good shalom bayis, parnassah, everything should be amazing. Where is it? Says the Chofetz Chaim, you know where it comes from? You know where it stems from? You know what the problem is? Says the Chofetz Chaim, very simple. The Yisem Kedoshim, be holy. Be holy. The camp should be holy. Says the Chofetz Chaim, the root of the problem is in ourselves. We have to keep ourselves holy. We have to rise up on our own. And then all the bracha, says the Chofetz Chaim, that every single person wants, can then be chal. You know, I spoke about this in the Sfas Emes on Hanukkah. The Sfas Emes has a wonderful thing. Says the Sfas Emes as follows. You ever wondered that there are three mitzvahs that are presumi nissa? We advertise the mitzvah, right? Mikra Megillah. On Purim, we like to read the Megillah. It's Pesumei Nissa. Dalet Kosos, the four cups on Pesach, right? Pesumei Nissa. And of course, lighting the Chanukah menorah is Pesumei Nissa. Why, says the Sfas Emes, are the first two done in private? True, Megillah is done in the shul, but it's not done in the street. We don't go out and read the Megillah in the middle of the street and tell everybody, look what happened to us. No, we put it in the shul, amongst people, and we do it there. Same thing with Dalet Kosos, the four cups of wine and Pesach. We close the doors of our house and we do it in the privacy of our own home. But Hanukkah, we take the menorah out in the street. Why? It's such a powerful thing. He says, because that's exactly what they wanted to do. In the times of the Yevonim of the Greeks, you know what they did? They took the streets and they put it into the Beis Hamikdash. They took the streets and they impurified them, atama the Beis Hamikdash. Therefore, on Hanukkah, we must do the opposite. We take our menorahs, we take our kedusha, our Torah, our tefillah, our mitzvahs, and we mekadosh the street. It's the same thing here, Rabbi Yisrael. How sad it is. In our own private lives, we'll take the street and fill our brains and fill our neshama, our body, with the street. It's out there, we're in over here, and yet we bring it in our homes, we bring it in our pockets, we bring it in our phones, in any sort of way. We take the street and we put it into our lives. We put it into our brain. And if you go behind every situation when you're confronted with looking at something you shouldn't be looking at, let's take a moment of psychology to figure out what's going on in your mind. At that moment, you're walking on the street and there's something on the other side of the street, then the corner of your eye, it hits you. And you have the choice at that moment. Do I turn or do I say, no, I don't want to. I'm not interested right now. So I go behind. You go behind the exact, you know, the brain at that moment. There's an unspoken promise. There's an unspoken promise that there's something here that you're going to enjoy. And it eats away at you and it says in the back of your head, you know, there's something there that's really going to give you a lot of pleasure. It's offering you something. The eye is the best salesman going. It will tell you, wow, there's something unbelievable out there. There's something that can give you pleasure, right? Look at this, there's something promising out there. And then you look, and then you realize after it's just empty. There's nothing there. If you'd put it to words, it wouldn't mean anything. If you had put to words what you're about to look at, if you have the mind to think at that moment, what am I about to do? Put it into words, please, for me. Nothing. It's empty. And just imagine, I always give this marshal, just imagine if you're very thirsty. You're thirsty, you're like, do me a favor, I just need a drink, please. No problem, I'll give you a cup of water that's got piles of salt in it. Salty water. You'll take the drink for maybe for a split second as the liquid goes down your palate. So it sort of, you know, doesn't, you know, it helps the dryness of your throat. But for a split second later, you're more thirsty than you were before. That's exactly what happens over here. You'll look for a moment because your eyes, your body is thirsty for it. You'll look. And maybe for a split second, you'll maybe quench that thirst for a split second. But for a minute later, you're even thirstier than you were before. Because it's like drinking salty water. It doesn't get any better. It doesn't get any easier. Rabbi Yisrael, it's even worse. For those that are married, for those that are going to get married, do you think this is going to improve your marriage? Do you think your marriage is going to get any better with this time? You know, how many people destroyed themselves with their marriage, with their children, with their community life? They ripped apart their entire life. Why? For one mice of pleasure. That's all it was. It was one mice of pleasure. And you'll ask them, was it worth it? Not one of them will tell you yes. Impossible. To sacrifice your entire lifetime, your life with a happy family, with the children, with a wife, with grandchildren, with community life, with everything. They sacrificed it and they left it. Why? Because of one maisa of physical pleasure. And Rabbi Sai, that's exactly what's going on. When we walk in the street, or when we have our phones, computers in front of us, we have that choice. Do you go down that way or do you not? Think for a moment. It might affect your marriage for the rest of your life. Because you're not going to look at your wife in the same way. And I guarantee that. And this is what people have told me personally. From people that I've dealt with in this situation. This is what's going on. This is what's happening. And we need to train ourselves now to realize. Not only are we dealing with something in the next world. You know, if Olam Haba doesn't scare you. And oh, what's Rabbi, give me a leave me alone with this next world business. And I'm going to be, you know, flown around in the next world. I can give you scary chazals. What's going to happen to you in the next world when you get up there. But let's leave that for a moment. Let's talk about here. Let's talk about now. If you look and you enjoy that sight, you will not enjoy your wife in the same way. Metzias, Rabbi Sai. Nobody can argue with that. And that's the people that have told me. It's poshut. So if you want to save yourself and you want to save your marriage, this is the way to do it. The training now, whether you're married or not married, doesn't make a difference. The training starts now.
You've just experienced another Torah class brought to you by TorahAnytime.com.